You know, that's really the Christian life right there. Too many times I don't bow my knee to what the Lord wants. And I just want my own way. I want to go my own path. I want to go my own direction. And God is saying simply, Ben, if you'll just bow the knee. I'm king, he says. You're not king. If you'll just bow the knee, what a difference that would make in our life. Humility is where it's at, folks. That's what God blesses. He resists pride, and he blesses humility. I trust this morning that as God's Spirit speaks in this message, you won't listen to the pastor. Don't listen to me. Listen to the very voice of God who comes to you and says, it's time for you to bow the knee. Maybe you're here today and you know if you died right now, you know you would not be in heaven. You know it. You don't need anybody to explain it to you. You know if you died right now, you would not be in heaven. My friend, it's time to bow the knee. It's time to bow the knee to what the gospel says. Christian, do you have an area of your life that's still yours? Time to bow the knee. Time to give it to the Lord. Have you given your life to the Lord? We find a very helpful passage of Scripture this morning, one of which that has always been a favorite of mine, because it talks to me about my redemption, how I know that I'm on my way to heaven this morning. You know what? I'd like for you to join me. I'd like for you to join me in heaven someday. But if you don't bow the knee to what this scripture talks about at some point in your life, you won't make it there. Morning, John. Tell John good morning from everyone. Wait till he's getting ready here. I think the bus driver was asleep, he said. I think he was telling somebody that. Did the bus driver fall asleep?
No, it's just so slow.
Slow, come on.
It was like a half an hour late. I waited for so long, but I kept positive. And even though the bus driver was so slow, I made it.
Hey. Thanks for coming, John. Hey, John, this is for you, John. That's for you. Wow. That's pretty convicting.
Sure is.
I don't know if it convicted you or not, but if it didn't, you're not awake. How can you not be convicted by that testimony? Just getting here. Amen. And how many times we just make excuses. Well, I'm not going to church this morning. You know, my left toenail's giving me a little trouble. I don't know if I have a left toenail. Maybe I do. Don't look. You don't want to know. Boy, I tell you, praise the Lord. One day I know that I'm going to be in heaven with the Lord. I know that not because of who I am, but because of who he is. This passage of Scripture is very encouraging to me. The theme that we're taking this morning is taken from verse number 19 that says, but with the precious blood of Christ, as of a lamb without blemish and without spot. My friends, there's no way that you and I can remove the blood of Jesus Christ from the plan of redemption. Some have looked at it as being, as us as believers, as a bloody religion, if you will. Why do we have to have a crucified Savior and blood this and blood that? My friends, the blood of Jesus Christ is necessary for you and I to have redemption. The hymn writers talk about it. The Word of God talks about it. Story is told of a time down in San Francisco in the Golden Gate Exposition. A so-called preacher was getting up and talking about things, and he began to direct his eloquence against the blood of Jesus Christ. There in the crowd was an elderly lady by the name of Ruth Marsden. She could take it no longer. She began to sing the song by William Cowper, "There is a fountain filled with blood, drawn from Emmanuel's veins. And sinners plunged beneath that flood lose all their guilty stains. Before she could reach the second verse, some 100 had begun to sing with her and continued singing with her. And by the end of the song, when they got to, "Dear dying lamb, thy precious blood shall never lose its power till all the ransomed church of God be saved to sin no more," they said that some 1,000 people were singing about the blood of the Lord Jesus Christ. My friend, that is blood. That blood is precious to us. The salvation plan is very simple to you, and it's very simple to me, in that it does not require much of us. Oh, but what it required of the Lord. What it required of the Lord Jesus Christ. This morning, the message is simple, but the message is expensive. The message is simple. The blood of Jesus Christ needs to be applied to all of our accounts, but it's very costly to the Lord. Nothing but the blood of Jesus can wash away my sin. I wonder today, have you put your faith and trust in the Lord Jesus Christ? Have you applied His blood to your account? I would say in a group this size, the majority probably have. But I would also say in this size, because of the number of people that are here today, the statistics would say that there are people here today that do not know Jesus Christ as Savior. I know those are just numbers, but you're not a number, you're a soul. You're not a number in my eyes today. I would have emphatically preached this if this, the front row would have been filled, because the blood of Jesus Christ is a valuable message. You're not a number in our eyes today. You're a precious soul in the eyes of the Lord Jesus Christ, who formed you, who made you, and would like to save you if you're not. Dear Christian, those of us today that have trusted the Lord Jesus Christ as Savior, may this truth today serve as an encouraging reminder of what we possess in Christ and that we'll never lose it. And I thank God for that this morning. Heavenly Father, thank You that all of us are here now. I thank You that John was able to make it. Thank You for his tenacity to get here and his good attitude, as he said. Oh, do we not need good attitudes today? Father, we have just a few moments to open Your word. But Father, these could be the few moments that change not just the one life, but change a whole family and change generations. I trust today that Your Spirit, the power that no man in here has, would fall on this place. In Jesus' name, amen. What did this blood produce? Number one, we see that this blood produced our Savior. Our Savior. Verse 20, the Bible says, "Who verily was foreordained before the foundation of the world, but was manifest in these last times for you." According to this verse, the Lord Jesus Christ was not given simply after the fall of man. That was already set in stone. It was already going to happen. It was something that God had put into place. Now, when Jesus Christ came to this earth and He walked on this earth, He accomplished several things. I'd like to give you a few of them this morning as we consider that the blood of Jesus Christ produced a Savior. I should say, I said our Savior, but I don't know if He's your Savior yet. He wants to be your Savior today if He's not already. But when He came to earth, John chapter 1 tells us that God became flesh. In the beginning was the Word, and the Word was with God, and the Word was God. In verse 14, the Bible says, "And the Word was made flesh and dwelt among us." Jesus, my friends, is the Son of God. Jesus is the Lamb of God, slain before the foundation of the world. He is the only Savior. He fulfilled Old Testament prophecies like that He would be born of a virgin, Isaiah chapter 7, verse number 14, that He would be born in Bethlehem, Micah chapter 5, verse number 2, that He was from the seed of David, Jeremiah chapter 23, verse number 5, that He was a man of sorrows, Matthew chapter 8, verse 20, Isaiah 53, 3. Old Testament prophecy after another fulfilled simply by the Lord Jesus Christ coming to this earth. The blood of Jesus Christ produced a Savior. The Lord Jesus Christ, as He walked the face of this earth, He zealously defended the truths of God's Word. In John chapter 2 and verse 15, He cleansed the temple. He is the Savior. Not a Savior, but He is the Savior this morning. I want us to dwell for just a moment on those previous verses. Not only did this blood produce a Savior, but this blood can help purchase a sinner. You know, when you go to the store and you look at an item, if you're like me, honestly, I don't really care what the item looks like at first. I try not to do that. Because if I fall in love with that item, it's too late. What do I look at? Price tag. I am a penny pinching shopper. I'm looking at the price tag. I go to that item, whatever it may be, and I'm looking, where's the tag? How much is this going to cost me? When I don't do that, not good. Because then I look at that tie at the Moores or wherever, and I'm, man, that's an awesome tie, and I flip it over. Oh, can't buy that one. Turn it, oh. So I turn them all over and look at the price tags. Then I find one in my budget, and I find a few in my budget, and then I look at those and say, all right, I can afford this one, and so then I choose that way. And maybe you don't shop that way, but maybe that's what the Lord wanted you to hear this morning, how to be a better shopper. No, I'm sure He wanted you to hear more than that. The price tag. The price tag on sin. How do we put a price tag on it? How do you put a dollar amount on it? You can't put a dollar amount on sin. You can't put a price tag on it. You see the word in verse 18, the Bible says the word redeemed. Redeemed. What does the word redeem mean? Well, I'm about to tell you. The word redeemed means to liberate by the payment of a ransom. To liberate by the payment of a ransom. Redeemed. Now, why do I need to be redeemed? Why do you need to be redeemed? Well, I'm glad you asked. Let's go to the prophet Isaiah and see what Isaiah said. Turn with me to Isaiah chapter 59. What payment? Why is the payment? Why does it need to be made? Isaiah chapter 59. Verse 1. Behold, the Lord's hand is not shortened that it cannot save. Amen. Neither His ear heavy that it cannot hear. But your iniquities have separated between you and your God, and your sins have hid His face from you that He will not hear. Get the picture there. My iniquities have separated between me and God. My sins have hid His face from me that He will not hear. Oh, my friends, I need to be redeemed because I am lost and I am separated from God. His hand is not short. It will save. He will reach down into the pit, as the Bible tells us. He reached down into the pit and pulled me up and set my feet upon a rock. And I'm so glad He did that for me. And He wants to do that for you. This is why I need to be redeemed. This is why, if we go back to 1 Peter, we see what we are redeemed with. Now, first, I'd like to go over this. What we are not redeemed with. Because you see, the Bible tells us in verse 18 that there must be a group of people, or there must be some people in this day when Peter was writing that had a misconception about redemption. Their misconception revolved around material things. Notice he says, you are not redeemed with silver and gold. What does that say? Okay, well, it says this. I'm not redeemed by putting money into the offering plate. I'm not redeemed by paying my penance, if you will. I'm not redeemed by tithing, although we ought to tithe as believers, but that's not how we are redeemed. I'm not redeemed by writing a big fat check to the church or a charity or to some, whatever it may be. That is not the way that I'm going to be redeemed, because then that rests in my ability to bring redemption. I'm a sinner. I can't redeem myself. But notice what else he says. Redeemed with silver and gold, from your vain conversation, received by what? Tradition from your fathers. So he goes back and he says, look, you cannot be redeemed, referring back to whatever the tradition was. It's man-made. I was talking to someone the other day, and we were talking about baptism. I have yet to find anything in this book right here about sprinkling. I just can't find it. You know, I mean, help me here, right? I can't find it. So did sprinkling come from God or from man? Man. That is a man-made tradition. I'm not here to be critical of you if you were ever sprinkled, but it didn't do anything but make you a wet baby. I'm sorry. Wherever that water came from, it just got you a little bit wet. It didn't do anything with your sin. It didn't make you closer to God. It didn't guarantee you eternal life. It simply made you wet. That is not something of God, my friends. That is a tradition of men. You know, but we have our traditions too. Let's not just pick on people that have, you know, those kind of things. We have our traditions. Let's be careful that we don't put ourselves into the realm of tradition, that we keep ourselves under the Word of God. Look, it says here, you are not redeemed by tradition of men. You are not redeemed by vain conversation. You are not redeemed by silver and gold. Boy, there's a lot of teaching today going on about you can be redeemed by this, or you can have peace with God in this way, or you can have peace with God in that way. And I took a survey recently of our Christian school club. By the way, thank you for praying. For truth be told, God is doing a great work. We had a table set up this last Wednesday. New Testaments were given out. Dunn books were given out. Flyers were given out with the gospel in the back of them. I mean, it must have hair-lipped the enemy something fierce. And we got to have the first table where all the kids walked into the rest of the tables. They had to walk by the gospel table, truth be told table. And we give God the glory, and I hope you'll keep praying for us. Now, here's the thing. Pray for us, because I'm praying that we can have a second truth be told. Pray with me on that. We need one of our public school kids to help us, though. One of you public school kids can help me with this, and I'm coming for you. You've got to be the sponsor. But we've got people ready. We already have somebody ready in our church to teach a second club right now. And it's not me. I can't clone myself. It's somebody. We have somebody that stepped up and said, I have time. How about it, teenager? Good. Are you concerned about your school? You have to be the initiator. Hey, who else is going to bring the blood of Jesus Christ into the public schools? The Christians have to. It's our responsibility, my friends. Who else is going to bring the plan of redemption into the workplace where you work? You are. Who else is going to take the plan of redemption to where you live? You are. I am. We should be. It's a great plan. It's designed by God. It's not a tradition. But notice here he says, you are not redeemed with corruptible things. You see, everything that I can do to make things right with God, they're corruptible. Hey, money is corruptible. Now, money given to a missionary who goes out and wins somebody to the Lord, what does that have? Eternal value. But money to buy a donut at Tim Hortons, man, that's corruptible. That donut's going to corrupt, you know? That's within my power. But the blood of Jesus Christ is incorruptible. The blood of Jesus Christ is perfect. It will never lose its power. You see, it's provided a Savior. It can purchase a sinner. Psalms 9:17 says, the wicked are turned into hell, and all nations that forget God. Oh, my goodness. Do we quite possibly live in a nation that is forgetting a holy God? Many, many nations forgetting a holy God. But let us be a remnant that says, as 2 Chronicles tells us, let us be God's people that are called by his name. Let us humble ourselves. Let us turn from our wicked ways. Let us confess our sin. Let us follow him unashamedly. Watch him do great and mighty things. It's produced a Savior. The blood did. It helps to, and it offers the purchase for a sinner. Verse 22 says, seeing ye have purified your souls in obeying the truth through the Spirit, this blood, the precious blood of the Lord Jesus Christ, can purify me, can purify you from sin. Verse 22 declares that obedience to the truth of God's word. I am simply a man, but I'm doing to the best of my ability with God's help to proclaim the word of God. If we obey the word of God, we find our souls to be purified. May it always be said that you and I are people of the book. Not a book, of the book. This book will never lead you contrary to the will and ways of God. But this book will always lead us down the straight and narrow path directly to a holy God. This book will be a light in a time of great darkness in our life. When we don't know what the next step is, this book will be there for you. This book will be a comfort when you're in a time of grieving or in a time of you're unsure of something. This is the book that you must attach yourself to. This book will never lead us astray. Notice it says here that purity comes as we are obedient to the truth through the Spirit. What truth is through the Spirit? The Word of God. My friends, the blood of Jesus Christ has the ability to purify us from sin. By the way, this has always been God's plan. Adam and Eve, Genesis chapter 3, verse 21. How about Cain and Abel? Genesis chapter 4, verses 2 and 4. Noah, after the flood, they sacrificed an altar on Genesis chapter 8, verses 20 and 21. And the Bible says that the sweet savor in verse 21, it pleased God. What pleased God? It was the sacrifice of Noah that he made there. You see, the blood brings us into a relationship with the Lord, into a relationship with God that nothing else can. See, nothing but the blood can produce a Savior. Is he your Savior? Nothing but the blood can purify me from sin. Nextly, look at verse 23. Being born again, not of corruptible seed, but of incorruptible, by the word of God, which liveth and abideth forever. The blood preserves us. It preserves us. What the blood does in us is a forever work. It isn't just a work that is done on the day of your salvation, but it is a continual working in you. You say, Pastor Turner, I'm a born-again believer. I know that I'm saved. You know what? Praise God for that. But you know what? The blood of Jesus Christ is not just important for the day you got saved. It is important 20 years later, 15 years later, 30 years later. It is the blood of Jesus Christ that helps us to have victory, that has taken the chains of sin from us and set us free. It is what we need to protect us. It is what preserves us. It gives me security. Remember what happened on the 10th plague? We were reminded of it in Bible Institute. I'm really loving Bible Institute. I hope if you have time on Tuesday nights next semester that you can join us at the church office on Tuesday nights from 6:30 to 9:30. I'm telling you, it is so helpful. But we were reminded of that 10th plague and how that the death angel came looking for something, right? Looking for the blood. Looking for the blood on the doorposts. And when the death angel saw the blood on the doorpost, the death angel passed over. Purified that home. If there was no blood, the death angel went in and the oldest child was killed. Because the family was not purified from destruction by the blood. Many years in Rotterdam, Holland, stood an old corner house known as the House of a Thousand Terrors. In the 16th century, King Philip II of Spain ruled over Holland. He tortured, maimed, and imprisoned and exiled thousands. Obviously, the people rose up in defiance. And the king sent an army under the control of the Duke of Alva to put down the rebellion. I was reading a little bit about this. The people were tired of being under this tyranny. And so the kings, they started to rebel, and the king said, enough of that, and he sent the troops over. The story was told of a family. They were huddled in their home, and the Spanish army was coming in, and the man of the home got an idea. They had a pet goat. The pet goat had to give his life. They killed their pet goat. It probably wasn't a pet. It probably was a source of food. They slit the throat of that goat, and they basically took the blood of that goat and they put it under the door to look like a big massacre had already happened there. And sure enough, that's exactly what happened. When the troops came by, they saw that blood was coming out from the house, and they figured, well, the job is already done. And that family was spared simply by the blood being on the ground, and they lived to tell about it. We don't understand that kind of oppression. We don't understand that kind of war, most of us. But oh, there's a greater war that's being held. There's a greater war that's being held today. By the way, there's a war being held right now in this room. It's a war between God's will and what God wants and the forces of evil. The war and the battle is for your soul. It's for your eternal destiny. You can't see it right now, but there's a battle going on. In fact, there's a battle going on in your life right now. Especially those of you that are not saved, there's a great battle going on right now. The enemy is trying to take your attention miles and miles and miles away from this room to anywhere he can take your attention so that your soul cannot be purified by the blood of the Lord Jesus Christ. The enemy is trying right now to distract you with anything and everything. Boy, I tell you, it's amazing what the enemy will do in a church service, and thankfully you don't see it all what I see sometimes from up here. Why does that happen? And things happen and we have to get up and move around. I'm not saying that. What I'm saying is I know some of it, though, is a direct result of the spiritual battle that is going on, that you and I, that you today that aren't saved, will not be purified by the blood of Jesus Christ, that the enemy will still have you in his clutches today. But I'm here to tell you this morning that God loves you. The blood has already been applied. Why don't you accept the Lord Jesus Christ today? Allow him to put the blood across your life so that you can be purified from him, from sin, by him. That's the only way it's going to happen. It's not going to happen by traditions. It's not going to be happened by a lot of money. It's only going to happen through the love of God. It's available for you today. It's available. Lastly, this blood brings a promise. Verses 24 and 25, this blood brings a promise. It's a promise of salvation. Acts 16:31, the Bible says, believe on the Lord Jesus Christ and thou shalt be saved. That's a promise. Let's go to Acts, please. Acts chapter 1. Acts chapter 1, verse 8. But ye shall receive power after that the Holy Ghost has come upon you, and ye shall be witnesses unto me. Hey, what are we to be witnessing about? We're to be witnessing about what we're talking about this morning. We're to be witnessing about what God has provided us through the blood of Jesus Christ. I was not saved because my mom and dad were Christians. That would be a corruptible thing. My parents are corruptible. They are sinners. My dad celebrated his 65th birthday yesterday, and it was a blessing to be able to talk to my dad on the phone a little bit. He's a great man and a godly man in my eyes. He's a sinner, but he's a godly man, but he's still a sinner. He can't save me. I'm not saved because my dad was saved. I'm saved because I applied the blood of Jesus Christ to my account. And it washed away my sin. Have you trusted Christ as your Savior? Are you Christian today? Are you being a witness? What is a witness? A witness is someone who testifies to what they have seen or what they've experienced. Are we witnessing what God has done in our life? What has God done in your life? Does it take a long time to remember what God has done in your life? Man, we have too much clogging our head if it does. You should be able to tell what God's done in your life just rapid fire, just like that. Be a witness of that. Story that I'll end with this morning as we kind of wrap this up. It's a story about a meeting that was taking place in Detroit, Michigan, many, many years ago. Many of us have heard of the evangelist Charles Finney. Maybe you've read about him or seen some of his quotes. Charles Finney was preaching in a church in Detroit, Michigan, years ago. After the meeting, a man approached him and asked him if he would come with him. He wanted to take him somewhere, and people of the church said, "I would not go with that man." Charles Finney said, "I believe God wants me to go with this man." So he went alone with this man, and this man took him into the back, took him down a dark alley, and took him into this building. He walked into this building, and the man shut the door behind him. And he said to Dr. Finney, he said, "Don't be alarmed. I'm not going to harm you in any way. I want to ask you some questions." The man said, "Sir, we're standing right now in the back of a saloon. I own this saloon." He said, "Dr. Finney," he said, "my goal when people come in here is that they leave drunk, that they spend all of their money on booze. That's my goal as the owner of this saloon." He paused and looked at Dr. Finney and he said, "Could God save and forgive a man like me?" You see, earlier that day, Dr. Finney had been preaching on 1 John chapter 1, verse 7, which says, "For the blood of Jesus Christ cleanseth us from all sin." He looked at that man and he said, "My answer to you is under the authority of the Word of God." And he quoted the verse to him that he had just preached on that day. "The blood of Jesus Christ cleanseth us from all sin." The man said, "Okay, I have another question for you. Another part of this building is a casino. It's a place of gambling. Somebody may not have a vice of alcohol, but they may like to gamble. My goal is to send them home penniless. No money to pay their bills, and all the money in my gambling place, if you will." He said, "Could God save a sinner like me?" Dr. Finney said, "Sir, my answer is based on the authority of the Word of God. For the blood of Jesus Christ, His Son, cleanseth us from all sin." The man said, "I have one more question. My family lives across the street from this building. In our apartment, said daughter, I have not said a kind word to my family in years. In fact, I've been very rude to my family. It hasn't been that I have just been rude to my family. I've been abusive to them. In fact," he said, "their bodies possibly would have some bruising because of me, my drunken condition." He bowed his head and he asked Dr. Finney again, "Dr. Finney, could God save and forgive a sinner like me?" This time Dr. Finney bowed his head and he began to cry a bit. He said, "Sir, I've never heard these kind of questions by one person ever. But," he said, "once again, I answer you under the authority of the Word of God. For the Jesus Christ, His Son, cleanseth us from all sin." That day, that man accepted the Lord Jesus Christ as his Savior. He was gloriously saved. He let Dr. Finney out the door, and then he went in and poured out all the liquor, tore up all the cards, went over across the way to his home. His little daughter met him like she always did, not anticipating a kind response because he had never really given her one in such a long time. She said, "Daddy, breakfast is ready." And he said, "I'm looking forward to it." He began to be kind to her. The daughter went to the mother and said, Mom, something's wrong with Dad. He was kind to me. He wasn't mean to me. Why is that? For the blood of Jesus Christ, His Son, cleanseth us from all sin. My friend, I don't know what kind of sinner you think you are or you aren't. You need the blood of Jesus Christ to be saved. It's not through silver and gold. It's not through vain tradition, but through the blood of Jesus Christ. Christian, if you're going to be victorious in your life, it's the same thing applied. The blood of Jesus Christ helps you to have victory, helps me to have victory. Oh, there's so many today in our world. Thousands of people in the Lower Mainland went to church this morning, and they checked off their religious duty for the week. Church, done. They left as lost as when they came. They were patted on the back by not a shepherd, not an under-shepherd. They were patted on the back that was someone who was more concerned about gain than truth. They heard some philosophy, possibly. A lot of them heard tradition. Things were done that are done every Sunday at some churches today. They call themselves a church. Hand motions were made like they're made every Sunday. Things were done like they're done every Sunday. Chants were chanted like they're chanted every Sunday. My friend, the Bible says all of those things are vain. They don't accomplish the work of God. Only by applying the blood of Jesus Christ can we have forgiveness. Have you applied that in your life? Hey, who do we know this morning that's lost without Christ, that needs the blood of Jesus Christ? They need a Savior. They need someone to bring the gospel to them and say, have you not considered the Lord Jesus? By the way, He keeps every promise. You may be here today thinking, well, my life is filled with this. Hey, the blood of Jesus Christ, His Son, cleanseth us from all sin. Let's have our heads bowed and eyes closed this morning.